Again, I'm a pharmacist. I work at the BC Center for Disease Control, which is where I'm located. I have no conflicts of interest to declare. So this is how the typical sort of mushroom call starts off. My child, or my dog eat a mushroom. Is it poisonous? What should we do? This is our fridge magnet. I don't know how many people have this, but our slogan, which has been borrowed from another poison center in the U.S., is don't guess, be sure, with our telephone number here. If I were completely honest, there's a bit of hyperbole here. Don't guess, be sure. So just a little bit of background about Poison Control Center, who we are. This talk is going to be in three parts, who we are, who we're not, and why it's called. So the Poison Control Center was actually started here at UBC as a project of the Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences back in the 1970s, possibly even earlier than that, late 60s, way before my time. I've been located at St. Paul's Hospital for many years up until 2010. And then in 2010, we physically moved over to the BC Center for Disease Control. And in 2011, we officially became part of Provincial Health Services Authority, which operates the BC Center for Disease Control. We have sort of three main services we provide. We do provide the drug information. This is therapeutic drug information to healthcare professionals only, and that's Monday to Friday, 9 to 4. We also have an educational role, so we're involved in both undergraduate pharmacy programs. We help with the nursing programs at the college level. We also do some public education in terms of poison prevention talks at health fairs, wellness groups, and things like that. But the bread and butter of our operation is the poison control line, which is a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week service to both healthcare providers and the public. And we serve the Yukon territories as well as BC. So that's what most people are familiar with us for. When you phone the poison control line, we are staffed by both nurses and pharmacists. So this is just a few of the friendly faces, hopefully friendly people that you will speak to if you happen to call us. We also have medical toxicologists. These are physician toxicologists who are on call when things get really bad. Typically, we would involve them if there's a serious case in the hospital or if we need a second opinion for something quite serious, which could include mushroom poisoning. This is just a snapshot of poisoning in BC. You can see, on average, we deal with about 23,000 to 25,000 exposures per year. You can see that the age categories down here are not evenly spaced, but you can see that more than half of our poisoning involve kids under the age of 6 years of age. And the second largest age category are the adults aged 20 to 64. Just looking at what kids get into, these are the most common substances involved in pediatric poisonings. Now, so we've got things like cosmetics and pain relievers, cleaning substances, foreign bodies. I think some people have told stories of foreign bodies in odd places. Cough and cold preparations, and plants are in there. But all this is to say that, you know, this is what we're used to dealing with. But sort of back to the topic at hand, mushroom poisoning. So, again, you get the call, my child ate this. And these are actual photographs of mushrooms that people have sent us after an exposure. Some of these photographs have come from hospitals. And some, I think Dr. Callan had mentioned, you know, what would happen if all the consultants were all in one place. And actually, most of the consultants that we use are in this room. So I have an acknowledgement slide on tomorrow's talk, but I should actually just acknowledge them while you're here. So Paul Kroger is the Poison Center's point person for most of our identifications, but Sharman has helped us out, Dr. Callan has helped us out, Dr. Burge, Dr. Burby has helped us out. The only people I can think of who are not here are Terry Taylor and Dr. Durrell in the interior, but everybody else who's ever been involved in a mushroom poisoning that I'm aware of is in this room, so thank you very much for your willingness to help. But yeah, the big question is, what is it? And for people people like me and the nurses and pharmacists on the poison control line, even with digital photographs, and what I've learned today is these photographs are probably not going to cut it. And I know from the example that Dr. Callan gave this morning, even with reasonable photographs and a lot of smart mycologists looking at it, there can, it's hard to come up with an agreement on some things. But you know, people always want to know, what is it? Bearing in mind that also, even if we were able to identify the mushroom, as many of you in this room know, the toxicity, the knowledge of the toxicity or the inability of most species is unknown. So this doesn't really help us. Again, getting back to what we see of mushroom poisonings from the poison control perspective is, you know, mushroom exposures are there in the blue, about 1% or less of our total exposure sort of call volume. And bearing in mind that mushroom season is usually concentrated in spring and fall, you know, this 1% doesn't give us a lot of opportunity to build a lot of expertise or things around identifying and things like that. So this 1% represents about anywhere from 150 to 230 mushroom exposures per year reported to the poison center. It's more than iron poisoning. It's more than antifreeze poisoning. It's way less than acetaminophen or Tylenol poisoning. But with even with iron and antifreeze poisoning, that's a single substance that we can actually develop some knowledge about. How many mushroom species are there in BC? Like 3,000 or something like that? Yeah, so you can see where the difficulties for us come in. So who we are not mycologists. And it's not just our center, we're not the odd duck out. Across North America, most poison centers are faced with the same thing. So this is just an example of what happens. So this is data from the U.S. poison control centers over a 10-year period. You know, 83,000 mushroom exposures reported over a 10-year period. Only about 5% of them actually had an identification. There's 185 species. And the most common species identified were these five. And those of you who are mushroom savvy would probably think, well, yeah, these are actually pretty easy to identify. And that represents about 1.9% of total exposures being reported. I've got a bunch of stolen pictures from the internet, so I won't show it, but you can see why those five are easily identified. So, back to our fridge magnet, don't guess, be sure. I phone this number with an exposure. These people don't know what these mushrooms are. I don't know, don't guess, be sure seems like a bit of an overstatement. You know, so you've had an exposure. Why you should still call us, though? Because these are some of the immediate questions that need to be running through your mind after exposure. Should I induce vomiting? Should I call 911? Should I rush my child or myself to the emergency department? What should I watch for? And so from a poison control center perspective, my answers would be, should I induce vomiting? No. Should I call 911? Probably not. Should I go to the emergency department? Depends. And what should I watch for? Tell you a little bit more about that. Now, why do we say this? Well, there's a little bit of data stuff. We do have some experience, even though we can't identify the mushrooms. We do have a little bit of experience with the poisoning aspect of it. So we do know that who's at risk for actual poisoning? Well, it's mostly going to be people who are foraging. And they would include people like the immigrants, Paul and Dr. Stamick have already mentioned, the inexperienced people out there, foodies, people who are experimenting and risk-taking. But again, a lot of our exposures involve kids. So what about kids? Well, this is, again, data from the U.S. Poison Centers over a 14-year period, ages less than six. Almost 60,000 exposures followed to a known outcome. There's a bunch of numbers down here, but the telling thing is over here is that more than 99% of children under the age of six who get exposed to a mushroom are going to be fine. So these would represent mostly exploratory kind of things, small nibbles and that sort of thing. And that's part of it. You know, there's an old saying in toxicology that the dose makes the poison. So kids eating smaller amounts are less likely to run into major problems. If you want, some of these major outcomes do include exposures to known poisonous species. Half of these major outcomes included seizures from ibotenic acid mushroom species. So things that could be identifiable. Should I induce vomiting? Should I call 911? Should I go to the emergency department? For most children, the answer is probably no, with some exceptions. So bear in mind that most poison control centers are in the same boat as us, and that we can't necessarily identify the mushroom readily or in a timely fashion that's going to help us manage the exposure. I asked the different poison centers in Canada. There's 5 poison centers across Canada. I also asked our colleagues in the Pacific Northwest, so Washington and Oregon, what their approaches to mushroom exposures are. And we're all on the same page. The basic approach that we use for asymptomatic mushroom exposures is we try to get as much history as we can. So that includes the who, the what, with an asterisk, how much, where, when, and why. And the what, again, is, you know, we can't identify the vast majority of mushrooms, but we'll try to rule out all these toxic varieties. And even that can be tricky, and it depends on the comfort level and the expertise of the poison control staff who are answering the call. But once we've done that step, again, for most small levels, the rule of thumb is home observation. Just watch you at home. We might do a follow-up if we're a little bit worried about you, or we might rely on the parent to call us back if symptoms occur, and at that point we'll take it further. For larger amounts, we would usually take the precautionary approach, and we'll recommend you go to hospital for what we call gastrointestinal decontamination. Again, we don't induce vomiting as a treatment for poisonings anymore, but we do things like administer activated charcoal slurry, which in theory might bind certain toxins and prevent them from being absorbed, and things like that. Also, send you into hospital for some baseline labs. And hopefully, everything will turn out normal. And we'll also ask people to save specimens in case symptoms develop. And for the past 2 years or so, less than 2 years, we have been trying to collect specimens for Dr. Burby's project. Hasn't always worked out. It has been easier to get specimens from hospital because there is a mechanism to get the specimens physically here. For the other ones that are still at home, I'd say a lot of people are interested in this project, and some say they will send a sample, but the number of samples actually arriving on my desk has been very small. Across the country, again, there is a little bit of variation in our approach. Actually, in Nova Scotia, this is the IWK Poison Center that's serving Nova Scotia and PEI. They're actually a little bit more conservative than centers, in that they will send in, actually, most of the mushroom exposures as a precautionary thing. And I don't know if that's because they've had some bad experiences or why they chose to go that route, but they are the most conservative of the Canadian poison centers. Just for interest, in Quebec, they have this Champignon 911, and they would recommend that you go to the hospital if your mushroom has any of these characteristics. Scales, dark scales on a light background, or flakes that look like oatmeal, a ring with this caution that it might actually fade and fall off if it has a vulva or a cup. Or if there's a group of orange-brown mushrooms growing in a group in the autumn, and that's for gilled mushrooms. Or for mushrooms without gills, and it looks like a little brain growing in the spring, you should go to hospital if you've ingested one of those. So what do we do for symptomatic mushroom exposures? Again, all this stuff is, if you've eaten the mushroom and there are no symptoms, you know, hopefully we'll just watch you at home unless it's been a larger ingestion. What happens is there, if you do have symptoms, well, again, physical identification of the mushroom for us is difficult. So what we mostly rely on is the syndrome identification. And that includes taking into consideration the time of onset between eating the mushroom and developing the symptoms, and then the constellation of symptoms, with some caveats that things can be confused because the time of onset, the symptoms can range. I think Paul nicely showed what happens with Batman and employees, that there's often a delay onset of symptoms of 6 hours before you start feeling gastrointestinal symptoms. But what if you've eaten a mixture of mushrooms, some of which may cause earlier gastrointestinal symptoms, or if you've eaten a large amount, or if you've eaten them raw? So this is useful, but it's not foolproof. If you've eaten mushrooms over 2 consecutive meals and things like that. So there are some caveats with the syndromic mushroom classification. And most mushroom guides would have a section on mushroom poisoning, which will include a description of these sorts of mushroom syndromes. But just for review, there's the early onset type of mushroom poisonings, with the gastrointestinal irritation type of mushrooms, which are very common, followed by, there's also neurotoxic mushrooms, gut muscarine, actinic acid muscle type mushrooms, psilocybin, I may have said it incorrectly, the alcohol reaction type of mushrooms here. And we've, at the Poison Center, we've had all these cases phoned into us. There are a few mushroom syndromes that don't appear to be a problem for us, at least not here on the West Coast. There's the late onset mushroom toxicities. Again, the cyclopeptide ones or the amanitophilloidy type mushrooms that we've talked about. We've had a few suspected gyrogatrin type poisonings reported to us, and we've definitely had some nephrotoxic mushrooms as well. Some of these are more obscure, really delayed onset type of mushroom poisoning, which at least in D.C. we have not had the unfortunate experience. But if there are symptomatic type of mushrooms, again, we then do try to get specimens if they're available and have them identified if possible. And that's where, again, a lot of the a lot of you in this room have helped out with that. That being said, why you should still call, once we've identified the type of mushroom poisoning that's been involved, then from the poison control perspective, we can then help advise the hospital on appropriate treatment. Unfortunately, a lot of it, there isn't really specific antidotes or specific treatments. A lot of it does come down to good supportive care, but at least helping inform the hospitals of what to expect, what to monitor, what are the likely outcomes are. Is still helpful for patient care. Another reason why, even though we can't identify your mushroom, why it's important for you to still call us. You may be thinking at this point, okay, they can identify the mushroom. Treatment is basically, they can't really do anything for me in terms of antidotes. Why should I continue to call? Well, it's still important to report because, like many things, if we don't report something that never gets spoken about, nobody's going to know what the problem is or if there is even a problem. So reporting does lead to things like warning signals and emerging threats, which can then lead to actions such as public service announcements and warnings, public health action like Dr. Sandwich talked about this morning, but also just fills that void, that dark matter sort of thing. We need data. We don't know exactly what's going on. So you've seen this, some of you have already seen this slide. So this was what we noticed last year. This is 2016's call volume of mushroom exposures to the Poison Control Center. And in July, we were about two to three times the normal call volume for mushroom exposures. And it's because we think we had a sort of cold spring. And coincident with this sort of, we noticed this sort of trend, I got an email from Paul who's forwarded another email saying, hey, death caps are fruiting earlier. Oh, boy. death caps are hooting early. We've got triple the number of mushroom exposures. Bad things are going to happen. We should probably warn people about it. And this led to the BC Center for Disease Control putting out a warning, which was then picked up by some news agencies. So, you know, why you should still call, because reporting is important. Again, it's that warning signal, the emerging threats. We need to have data, collect data so that we know what's happening. And tomorrow, Paul and I are going to unpack a little bit more of the data from the Poison Center. But really, you know, without you, none of this happens. So you make that call. So in the end, you know, instead of that fridge magnet saying, don't guess, be sure, for mushroom poisonings, I'd like to change it to keep calm, but give us a call. And that's about all I have to say about the Poison Control Center perspective, except this is, and I know a lot of you mushroom consultants will also cringe at this sort of thing. No, this is not the kind of call that we would like to have at the Poison Control Center. This is a call that I got at around 10:30 at night on one of my shifts. Somebody's obviously gone through a lot of work to pick these. I won't say where he got them from, but it was someplace where he wasn't supposed to.